yet because, like, this is only my first movie. And so, like, after I do maybe 100 or so, then I think I might.
Aileen Quinn, 10 years old. She's Annie in the new movie, chosen over 8,000 other little girls. It was hard work and fun. Now she's back home with $100,000 in the bank.
Someday, Aileen Quinn may be telling her grandchildren that the first movie she starred in took her from the East Coast to Hollywood. That the filming took her to a fantasy world of millionaires' mansions and studio back lots.
And what's that fifth time turning you always?
That the movie world gasped that her first film might have cost something around $40 million. And that she worked with some of the biggest names in Hollywood. Albert Finney, Carol Burnett, and the renowned director, John Huston. Aileen Quinn may tell those grandchildren that she was barely 10 that summer Annie was made. And that she didn't know then what it meant when people said she might become the next great child star.
Being an actress is like being a little girl because it's fun for me. It's just like going out and playing in the yard. But to make me a star, I think I've got to still take my, you know, my dancing lessons. I can't quit on that. And still, you know, take singing lessons and, you know, keep up my acting and, you know, just keep on doing things and practice, because practice makes perfect.
Annie, yeah. Look what you've done for us.
Great.
Columbia Pictures is so enchanted with her ability to sing and dance and act that the company's trying to make this unknown a household word. Aileen Quinn, or is it Annie, is on view everywhere. There are posters adorning the walls of movie theaters, publicity shots in newspapers and magazines, and contracts for personal appearances all around the country. So far, Aileen's image fits beautifully in the tradition of the great child stars of the past. She has the musical promise that Judy Garland showed in so many films of the 30s and 40s.
We're tying a knot. They never can sever.
And like Shirley Temple, she's got that lovable mug you just can't resist. Put a pair of tap shoes on a kid like this, and she'll just dance her way into your heart. And like those children of the past, Aileen Quinn has that tough inner discipline, that strong drive for success. Qualities she needed to beat out the competition and get her first big break, that starring role as Little Orphan Annie.
You know, I just said I'm going to try my best, and, you know, if I don't get it, I don't get it, but I'm just going to try my best, and that's all I can do is try my best.
Lots of little girls wanted to be Annie. Over 8,000 were auditioned in 22 different cities on two different continents. Director John Huston winnowed the group down to just 9 girls. There was something that separated brown-haired Aileen from the other contestants.
She's a joy, an enormous talent. I'm sure that the 3 wise men came and offered her gifts, and she's the archetype. She's the original little girl, beautiful, wonderful little girl.
It's a really swell locket, Mr. Warbucks, but if it's all the same to
you... In January 1981, after over 1 year of searching, Columbia Pictures chose Aileen as one of just 3 finalists. The last step, a screen test with Albert Finney. Without the makeup or dyed hair or red wig that would transform her into Annie. It was here that Aileen cinched the role and charmed the cast she'd soon be working with.
She's blessed with a light, an inner light, and you like looking at her. And no matter how talented somebody is, the fact that above and beyond their talent, you're interested and you enjoy looking at them and you get pleasure from looking at them is a bonus.
Aileen Quinn's rise to stardom had had all the qualities of a fairy tale up to this point. But Annie would take 6 months to film. And Aileen would learn that the day-to-day life of a film star means hard work and dealing with dozens of people who tell you what to do.
What in the world are you doing?
Getting
stabbed to death.
But discipline had brought her this far, and it would carry her the rest of the way. She'd never taken an acting lesson in her life. But the kind of tenacity that makes her an A student in school enabled Aileen to master the tasks of a movie star. She was brought up to be polite and respectful and obedient. And under the watchful eye of John Huston, Aileen rehearsed her scenes.
And honey, you can be on your knees.
Slowly bringing to life the magical qualities of the cartoon character she played.
Once more.
The days were long, and Aileen had little time to play with new friends.
I was in New Jersey when the finale was done, and it was 2 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, yeah.
Weren't you tired?
No, because, like I said, I like what I'm doing, and besides that, I like to stay up at night and sleep in the afternoon. So it was, I know it sounds weird, but I liked working at night. It was fun, because and one night I got to see the sun come up. It was so hilarious.
Most of the long hours Aileen put in were spent carefully crafting Annie's many musical numbers. This one is A Hard Knock Life, one of the movie's biggest production sequences. For just this one song, it would take 3 weeks of rehearsal.
Don't it feel like the wind is always howling? Don't it seem like there's never any love?
But like the character she plays, Aileen Quinn is a determined little person, cheerful and cooperative, almost eager in the face of hard work.
Well, Hard Knock Life is a very long number, and it has a lot of different moves in it. And like after you rehearsed it for a long, long time, then they'll just like the day before filming, you know, brush it up and, you know, clean everything up, just so it's, you know, like perfect.
Empty belly life, one smelly life.
It took 5 days to shoot A Hard Knock Life. Aileen Quinn's performance was pure energy. In the words of one of the picture's executives, she did it right the first time, every time. This is one of the sets from Annie, and it's where Aileen Quinn spent a few weeks last summer, but the day came when work was over, and the little actress went back to being the little girl from Yardley, Pennsylvania. Except for the Annie jacket she wears, you might mistake Aileen for any other fifth grader, saying goodbye to friends at the end of the day and turning in at the backyard fence with her 7-year-old brother, Drew. Aileen's banked $100,000 for her starring role, but she seemed completely unaffected by her celebrity status. She was just happy to be home.
It feels good because, you know, I got to see all my school friends again. And, you know, I'm going back to school now, and I'm playing with my friends that live where I live, in back of me. And so everything's back to normal again.
She attends the Connect Dance Academy 3 afternoons a week, where she brushes up all types of routines, including her favorite, tap dancing. Aileen's been taking lessons for over 6 years, and according to her dance teacher, she is the most talented child he's ever worked with.
Do it again.
So far, no one, including Aileen's mother, is worried that Aileen's childhood is so far from childlike.
It was never work to Aileen. And as soon as she would walk off, she was the little girl, whether it was to walk off on a break and play jacks or go over and color in a coloring book, because I think underlying it all, she always was the little girl.
Do you feel like a star?
Well, not really, because I think of myself as just normal Aileen. I don't think of myself as a star yet, because, like, this is only my first movie. And so, like, after I do maybe 100 or so, then I think I might. But right now, I just think of myself as Aileen.
Question is, how long can Aileen Quinn remain just the little girl from Yardley, Pennsylvania? Over the last year, she's been programmed to be a movie star. She's acquired the polish and sophistication of a person far beyond her 10 years. Does she realize that? Annie's executive producer doesn't think she knows yet.
She's happy being Annie, you say, I think. I think she's proud of that, that she's the one who's gotten. She's not, her ego hasn't changed. She's just thrilled still that she's playing the role of Annie.
She certainly doesn't cross.
And when director John Huston decided she should perform the hit song Tomorrow, A New Way, Aileen knew just how it should be sung.
Everybody expects it to be, you know, like loud and strong, but it's going to be very quiet.
How do you sing it?
Like, The sun will come out tomorrow. Just very soft like that through the whole song.
Is that a sad song?
No. Yeah, I think of it as a cheerful song. Because, you know, you're saying about the next day, you know, it's going to be sunny and it's going to be like a great day. When I'm stuck with a day that's gray and lonely.
So imagine being in her place right now, living in a world most people only dream of, seeing it all through the eyes of a 10-year-old. Quite a story. A very happy beginning.
Tomorrow, so you gotta hang on till tomorrow. Come what may, tomorrow.
What takes place in hard times and still shimmers with glamour, with characters, both in front and in back of the camera.
Complete rehearsal.
What gets pounded, painted, welded, and scored.
Hey, stand by.
And has stained glass ceilings and marbled floors. What's crowded with extras, actors, and arcs?
A little closer.
What smiles, and frowns, and bellows, and barks? What has chases in strange places, and magical things?
Come on down.
A bald billionaire, and an orphan. That sings.
The sun'll come out tomorrow, so you gotta hang on till tomorrow.
What works all day long and on into the night?
The party goes on forever.
Let's do it once more.
What takes lots of takes to get it just right? What's years in the making? It starts with an A.
Of course, it's Annie. It's only a dream away.
As producer, Stark's next step was to find a director.
Perhaps people were surprised by my selection of John Huston to direct a musical. But actually, he was my first choice.
Once we've done this...
First of all, he has a real understanding of the period. And his films reflect a reality, a dramatic style, and taste and elegance. All the things Annie would need for the screen. For the role of Daddy Warbucks, we wanted a man with the ability to be stylish and elegant, and at the same time, have confidence enough as an actor to be broad.
I don't like it. Send it back.
Stark chose the distinguished English actor, Albert Finney.
Little cheeks, little teeth. Everything.
There was only one person we had in mind for Miss Hannigan. Carol Burnett.
Carol Burnett is known for her extraordinary versatility. Her many characterizations resulted in the phenomenal 11-year run of her own television show.
The pop recording artist, Tim Curry, actually started his career as a Shakespearean actor and recently was acclaimed on Broadway for his role of Mozart in Amadeus.
But it was the Rocky Horror Picture Show that convinced John he had found the man to play Rooster, Miss Hannigan's no good brother.
For the role of Lily, Rooster's girlfriend, we picked Bernadette Peters, the young actress who had starred in The Jerk and has been compared to Carol Lombard and Jean Arthur as a classic American comedienne.
An important new angle we've added to the movie is the romance between Daddy Warbucks and his secretary, Grace Farrell.
Stark needed an actress who was fresh and attractive and who could also sing and dance. He chose Anne Reinking, one of the star attractions of All That Jazz.
We got Annie!
Jeff Hollywood for more auditioning.
What?
They sang and danced under the guidance of executive producer Joe Layton.
It's a hard knock life. For us, it's a hard knock life.
since it was Christmas and all the nine finalists were so talented, Stark decided to give each of them a part in the movie. 8,000 little girls, nine hopeful semi-finalists, but only one, Annie.
From the moment I saw her, I thought and hoped that she would be Annie. From the very instant I first saw her, Miss Eileen Quinn.
Annie's director, John Huston, made the announcement and then greeted his new young star, 9-year-old Eileen Quinn from Yardley, Pennsylvania.
What did you do as soon as you found out that you were Annie?
Well, first, Garrison Drew told me, and I wouldn't believe him. I thought he was just, you know, kidding me. But he wasn't.
Eileen, who lives with her parents, grandparents, and younger brother, has, for the last 6 months, been appearing in the Broadway cast of Annie, but ironically, as an understudy to The Orphans. On hand, in addition to director Huston, was Carol Burnett, who will play the role of the nasty Miss Hannigan, who runs the orphanage. For Burnett, it seemed to be love at first sight.
Eileen, would you just get in my purse so I can take you home? I can't be mean to this kid.
Last Saturday, three of the girls, including Eileen, were screen tested with Albert Finney, who will play Daddy Warbucks.
You've given me so much already, Mr. Warbucks.
Farrell's had the paper signed today. It's official.
What is?
The night before the screen test, she was looking over her material, and she was starting to ask me, well, what about this line or what about that line? And I knew that it had to be her interpretation. It had to come from within her.
Mr. Warbucks, when my folks left me at the orphanage 10 years ago, they left a note saying that they'd come back to get me as soon as they could. And I said, how should I say this? Because, you know, I couldn't figure out a way. So she said, believe me, when you start acting with him, you'll know how to say it. And she was right.
Eileen Quinn, who plays Annie, is just a remarkable little girl. What a face.
This doesn't look like a boy. Orphans are boys.
Oh, you didn't say you wanted a boy, sir. You just said an orphan, so I got a girl.
I want a boy.
It's a really swell idea to have an orphan for a week, Mr. Warbucks. A really terrific idea. Even if it's only for your image. Even if I'm not the orphan, I'm glad you're doing it.
I'm glad you approve.
She did a thing one day I've never seen before. Everything was done to playback. Her songs, that is. She had a very heavy scene with Ann Reinking. And there was no music to go back to. So on the stage, with a pitch pipe as a starter, she recorded that song with a huge company listening. It was perfect. She's got perfect ear. And we used that recording then to play back in order to do the scene with. I've never seen that done before. It was incredible.
Town ain't so bad. You'll take the ferry and visit me and my mom and my dad.
She's very quick. I noticed how quickly she picked up the steps, how musically her mind was always aware of where the rhythm was, where the beat was, a good sense of rhythm, a real good sense of rhythm.
Well, I've had tap, ballet, and jazz. I just started jazz. But I've taken tap for 5 years, and I've taken ballet for 5.5 years. I want to be an actress when I grow up.
On the set at dawn.
Dawn? I better set my alarm. I'm gonna like it here, I think.
Scene 1 will shoot from 10 to 4.
All day long for one scene?
Make sure you know your lines, my dear.
Leaping lizards? Look at all these pages.
Your dancing lesson is at 5.
Gee, Hollywood sure keeps you busy. I think I'm gonna like it here.
Made your start, got the part, now it's up to you. Dance or sing, anything, do the best you can do.
Does everybody work this hard?
pick it up. Come on, pick it up. Bingo. Come on, pick it up. Let's go. Come on. Pick it up. Pick it up. So bad. Pick it up. Come on, Glenn. Come on. Go on.
Take the very end. Visit me and my mom and my dad.
Bingo. Bingo, come on back. Bingo. Come on, Bingo. Pick it up. 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 Take it. Down.
Boy, all right.
Good, Bingo.
And it's the same thing on this movie. When the kids and the dog are right, everyone else better be right, because that's the print.
And in the number called It's a Hard Knock Life, getting it right involved over 40 boisterous kids and one brave grown-up.
I'm choreographing the film of Annie, which involves doing all the steps and helping to organize all the musical numbers in the film.
Now roll to the side.
That's it. So we see your face and then not okay. Your body popping up. In Hard Knock Life, it's just to show the miserable time that the children have in the orphanages, but also they have a lot of fun too. So what I've used in this, I decided to, as gymnastics is so popular now, to get children who are good at gymnastics and incorporate it all into the action of the orphanage. And basically what happens whenever there's a monitor around or Miss Hannigan, they're sitting there doing their work. And every time that anyone leaves the room, they go crazy. They're swinging on lamps and flying on beds and diving through the air and generally just having a good time. The numbers could be much bigger than they ever were in the play. And there's sort of no limit. You can say what you want and how many people should be there, and then it's discussed and say, okay, go ahead. You know, if I want 60 for this or 40 for this or 38 for this, whatever, the numbers sort of are meaningless, so that's exciting.
Okay, so Julie and Sabrina, be aware that you're going to do the aerial and cross straight back again.
Why can't she come any sooner?
Because Lisa's in.
Right, let me say once again. You go across, you go back, but then I want them to try and cross again behind Carol. Oh, it's hard working with children. It's very, very different to working with adults. You have to allow them so much more. And you can discipline them, but they're so noisy. And you only have to have one in ten who's noisy, and you can disrupt the whole rehearsal.
And Melissa, go. Okay. All right, girls, easy on the screams. It's early in the morning yet, please.
Are you concentrating? You sure you'll remember this time? And then also we've been rehearsing long, and kids get mean to each other after they've been rehearsing a while and watching who's going to get the next step. With adults, you know, if you do something, you do it. If you don't, you don't. They can accept it. Children are just watching like, ooh, if somebody gets something more to do than the next kid, boy, they're mean. The girl that comes down the center,
practically handheld, I'd say, Harry. You know, any
coming
of this
to
stuff.
Almost working with John Huston is just such a great experience. I was so nervous when I first met him, and he's been so nice. I mean, I hope that, you know, he likes what I do, but I'm always kind of running there and back as I'm working, hoping that this is the shot that he wants, and this is the kids are doing what he wants, and I'm very, very nervous around him, but it's wonderful.
And where does she go?
She walks all the way through. She goes over to Robin, who's standing, holding the...
Let me see what she does.
Okay, Robin's standing just holding the place of
do
Mush
the whole
in a dream.
Thing just to do
okay,
flat.
Go. Five, six, seven, go. One, two, three, and step. And go! Put, throw, throw.
That old belief that you should beware of children and animals is absurd. If you know anything about children and animals, they live up to your expectations, always. Well, very good, though. Now, we lose the fun of that thing of her sitting up on top, don't we?
Yes.
I don't know.
We could pull the plate up and drop down to see Aileen. There's time enough in the music.
All right, let's try and do that.
Go! Look,
boy,
you're going like this. Like that.
Whoa.
Throw them. Let me see you. Go.
here, although they're strict about how many hours they work a day, these children can work any day of the year they want, and some of these children have hardly been in school other than the schooling they get on the stage. They've done commercials, television shows.
It's the hard knock life for us. It's the hard knock life for us. Life becomes a boring blur when you are a stage mother. It's the hard knock life.
In the stage production of Annie, one of the show-stopping numbers is Easy Street, which features the three villains, the evil Miss Hannigan, her no-good brother Rooster, and his cheeky girlfriend, Lily St. Regis. In the movie, these roles are played by Carol Burnett, Tim Curry, and Bernadette Peters. The chemistry between these three actors is crucial to the vitality of the scene.
I'm a dancer.
How do we start? Well, we come to a big empty sound stage, and it's dark, and there's a little light on somewhere, and it's a rehearsal pianist.
And then on the word soon is where the orchestra track starts.
I play by rear.
I remember the way our sainted mother would sit and croon us her lullaby. She'd say, kids, there's a place it's like no other. You gotta get there before you die.
You don't get there by playing from the rule book.
You stack the aces.
You load the dice.
Mother dear,
now we know you're down there listening. How can we follow your sweet advice?
It's very important because it has to seem like, it has to have the same energy as if you're doing something, performing it live at that moment, which when you're filming, you're not singing live at that moment. You may feel like jumping in the air, and at pre-record, it doesn't sound like you're jumping in the air. It just sounds like you're singing it, standing there straight. So you have to take all those things into consideration.
Put your hand in now, Tom.
Yes, you stack the aces.
You load the dice.
Mother dear, oh, we know you're down there listening.
Do you post?
How can we follow your sweet advice?
I was doing a play in New York, and there was a stagehand who I thought was perfect sort of physically for Rooster, because he was never still, he was squirm, always kind of pulling up his trousers.
Do the first word in there.
So John said, what are you going to do with the part? And I said, well, I'm just...
Turn into him?
He said, oh, fine.
That was a second. Here it comes.
Easy Street.
And go with it.
Easy Street.
Our concept of Easy Street was to do the usual thing in a musical.
Yeah.
And that's open it up.
You show it to the director, you show it to the producer. They decide whether or not they like it or not. If they like it, it stays. If they don't like it, you go back and start all over again. And hopefully they like it then. And then you start shooting it.
We had this million-dollar street, and we thought that by filling it with happy street merchants and putting a driving musical number behind these three marvelous personalities, that would be the answer. We did the number, and it didn't come out to compare with what we considered almost the perfection of the rest of the picture.
Got it!
It
it was really rather a sticking out in an intimate musical. We gambled and did it all over.
The game with something shady.
Because we decided that the personalities and the abilities.
Take it, Tim.
Bernadette Peters, Tim Curry, and Carol Burnett.
Three.
Were more interesting to an audience than seeing a lot of nameless and faceless street merchants interrupting a dance.
Some of the names, like Best Boy and things. I mean, I always wonder when the credits go up in a cinema and people see Gaffer and Best Boy and things. Best Boy.
An elephant getting roller skates put on, do you? The trouble is being an actor that if anything goes wrong, you're the ones they recognize. You're the ones that get the eggs and the tomatoes thrown at you. But sometimes it's not our fault. It's Ray Stocks or maybe a carpenter. New Jersey's Monmouth College doubled as Daddy Warbucks' mansion.
Take her up.
For Annie's most elaborate production number, 50 actors, 220 crew members, 300 extras, and a complete circus troupe stormed the administration building to film a party. There was plenty of room for confusion.
The minute they start singing, again, you have to juggle separately.
Right.
Follow?
And the original show was Christmas. Since we were shooting in the summertime, it was hard to get snow in New York City. So we shifted it to the 4th of July, being holiday spirit and being patriotic seemed perfect.
This is your waltz.
I mean, I really am crazy.
Yeah? How high is it?
20 feet. 20 feet high.
How high? Up there in the sky.
High like an airplane.
You'd be sitting on his back. How do you fancy about that?
I don't care. That was the mansion, and we had to do all kinds of stuff.
The little one is there. Don't burn her.
This torch is going to be lit. It's going to be fire coming. I won't get it too close to you, so don't worry.
On a 7-foot unicycle, I had to do a back bend on his hands up in the air. And it was really fun. I was nervous at the first time. You're going to pick me up?
Yeah.
Nice bridge over there.
Hello, operator.
I want him out. Get him out, everybody, please.
When we were filming inside, there's this sort of small army of guys outside. It's quietly building it. That's what audiences often don't realize, you know, the amount of work that's gone into something that you may only see sometimes. You know, you may see $1 million worth of effects go through in 10 seconds.
Now you go, we got it.
Okay.
So you've got the dance and you've got to involve the circus and the other orphans.
We also have grass and trees and hundreds of lights. And all of that has to be rehearsed on cue.
There's a lot going on there.
The last count, I think, was 10,000 electric light bulbs.
And together, playback.
You rock me around.
Okay, go again with a rehearsal guide.
You made like a song.
Albert Finney was not a dancer. I first met him in London and had one brief class together, and to find out that, no, he couldn't really dance at all, but was very willing.
Not having attended the Fred Astaire dance school all my life, I was a little worried about being able to get the changes right, you know.
He learned everything he had to learn in a short space of time.
When we were rehearsing, if I felt I was going wrong, I used to look at Aileen and see what she was doing and know that it'd be right.
It was fun having him move, and he was a really good sport about it.
And then, as they force us back out by coming downstage, that's when all the juggling thing takes place.
Shooting on real locations gives you a reality that is very difficult to achieve on a stage. You can do it, but it's difficult. But that was part of the challenge, and for me, a great deal of the enjoyment.
And the first thing that happens is get rid of all of the equipment off the stage. That's not part of it.
Move them down over there and just have them ready.
Okay.
I was going to tell a dirty joke. No, I can't. No,
yeah,
I can't.
We'll cover it.
More activity on the sides, on the outsides, please.
No, you have
on a production of this size and expense, the coordination of each department is especially critical.
You know, these creative people are wonderful and fine, but you got to give them a little discipline once in a while.
Now, the question is...
So you gotta say, fine, okay, now fellas, how long is it gonna be? Okay, 30 minutes, okay, 30 minutes, it's 9:30, at 10 we'll be ready, right? And you hope that they are ready.
Now move, everybody, go, move, just run, go ahead. Roe is gonna begin to light, and at the same time, Joe is gonna begin to stage the circus. All right, unicycles, please be ready. Just be ready to go.
The AD has the problem of keeping the cast happy by virtue of not letting them sit around unnecessarily long, either on the set or even, for that matter, in their dressing room.
The main job for an assistant director is to run the set, to have everything there for the director, have the mood, the atmosphere, have the artists ready for the director to work with.
Okay. And I don't have any idea what's going on.
We zoom in to a full figure.
Bit by bit, the scene is reconstructed with the stand-ins, and marks have been placed on the floor, after all, with the principals during the initial rehearsal, and we reconstruct the whole scene so that we have a good idea as to what the camera position will be and who's going to be sitting where at any given moment.
There we go. That's it, and enjoy.
The principal actors are brought back in, and hopefully we can start shooting right away on the basis of all this lighting and pre-production that's been done prior to their coming back. The fewer times they have to go through the scene, take after take, the better, to keep their energy level up.
Stand by. Chris, let me have some more dowagers. Come, dowagers.
Let's get a rehearsal outside.
Fire!
Unbelievable.
All right, where's props? I need to get
this way. That's all. It just there's something there.
The teenage boys in that corner.
What am I going to do with them? Now look, watch out.
We got Annie.
Watch out.
All right, we've got until midnight to get it. The little girl. Until midnight.
I mean, the torches, then it's all right on there. Number one, guys, places, fight your way through. Will you get out of here? Action. Go, Eddie.
You get everyone working together, and you get all these energies just geared to one spot. You know, you can do wonderful things.
I don't need sunshine now to turn my skies to blue.
I don't need anything but you.
very complicated process involving many, many, many people.
You've wrapped me around.
And of course, because of many, many people, many, many things can go wrong.
You've made life a song. You've made me the singer.
But when they don't, and when it works, it really works.
Up your meat.